Lately, we've been hearing a lot about large language models, or LLMs for short. Many of you have probably heard of or tried using ChatGPT, for instance. And these models, they are a type of artificial intelligence, one that uses deep learning techniques and massive data sets to understand and produce language so convincingly that sometimes it's hard to know whether a given text was written by a human or AI. And the rise of artificial intelligence and these powerful language models has fueled a lot of debate and anxiety over how AI may pose a threat to humankind, how it might take away our jobs or even take over the world. Now, as the CEO of an AI company, I tend to have a rather optimistic outlook on how AI will shape our future. I do think some job automation will probably happen, but I, for one, am rather looking forward to handing full control of my inbox over to an intelligent chatbot. There is, however, one aspect of this AI revolution that we are living through that worries me a bit, and it has to do with language. More specifically, my language, Icelandic, or really almost any language that is not English. My concern is that the rise of artificial intelligence and the in the field of language technology will accelerate the digital death of small languages. What I mean by digital death, by the way, is that the native speakers of a language stop using it altogether in the digital domain, for whatever reason, but usually because it's just not as convenient as using a more dominant language like English. And with the virtual domain occupying more and more of our time and our children's time, well, then the digital death of a language can actually threaten its very existence. Now, this is not Armageddon that I'm describing here. Obviously, the survival of humankind is not going to depend on the ability of a few hundred thousand souls on an island in the North Atlantic to save our language and our cultural heritage. But I like my language, and I would like to keep speaking it, and more importantly, I want my kids to speak it. So to me, the stakes feel pretty high. Now, to better explain why I think AI may have an impact on small languages and their digital well-being, let me first tell you a bit about the state of linguistic diversity within language technology prior to the arrival of ChatGPT and all those other fancy chatbots. It will surprise no one to hear that by far the most used language on the internet is English. Considering that less than 5% of humankind actually speak English as their first language, I think we can safely assume that a lot of internet users are producing and consuming content in a language that is not their own. And there are good reasons for why we prefer English on the web. You only need to ask yourself, when was the last time you Googled something in English? Because an equivalent search in Icelandic or some other language didn't return any useful results. And this extends beyond Google searches too. If I want to ask Apple Siri a question, I cannot do that in Icelandic, she will not understand me. And I can text a friend faster in English than in a different language because the autocomplete works better. And so on and so forth. I bet a lot of you have had similar experiences. And those use cases I just mentioned, by the way, they all fall under the umbrella of natural language processing, or NLP. That's a fancy way of saying language technology. So do machine translation, grammar and spell checking, and a lot of other tools that most people use in their daily lives. But even though you've been using language technology a lot, maybe you haven't thought a lot about how it works. So let me give you an idea. One of the things that my company has developed is a voice assistant app, her name is Embla, that can answer various types of questions in Icelandic, like when is the next bus arriving? And this is how she does it. The first thing you have to have in place is an automatic speech recognition system. An ASR system will take speech as its input, and it will output a text representation of the user's query. An ASR system needs to be pretty robust. It has to understand different accents and voices. It needs to cope with ambient noise. It needs to know where one word ends and another one begins, and so on and so forth. Now, once you have your text representation of the query, well, then your system needs to understand the question and be able to analyze it for intent. And for that, you need a grammar of the language, which is essentially a system that maps out the different parts of speech and how they all relate to each other. So what's the subject of a sentence, the object, the verb, etc. And of course, what do all of these individual words mean? And once the meaning of the question is clear, well, then your system needs to find the answer by looking it up in some database or perhaps plugging in a pre-programmed reply. Then it needs to take the information it finds and use the grammar to turn it into a well-formed Icelandic sentence. Finally, a speech synthesizer will take the written response to the question and turn it into spoken word that gets delivered back to the user. In this case, Embla points me to the next bus. And this entire process should ideally take less than 1 second. Now, as you can imagine, a lot of time and resources went into creating the different components that make up the single use case. And this is pretty basic technology compared to what today's LLMs can do. Embla can tell you what time it is, but she cannot write you a poem about time, like ChatGPT can do, or even tell you the time in a language that is not Icelandic. But basic or not, a lot of languages do not have an Embla-like app, or quality machine translation, or even a spell checker. In fact, a vast majority of the world's 7,000 languages are considered low resource in the context of language technology. Historically, when it comes to NLP and big tech, English is the priority, and the rest of the languages, well, they're more of an afterthought. Now, traditional NLP still has its uses, but a lot of it is being replaced by generative AI, and that comes with its own set of challenges. If there's one thing most of you probably know about large language models, it's that they are trained on a lot of data. And because English is so dominant on the internet, that means we have access to way more data in English than in any other language. When we talk about the amount of data that went into training an LLM like GPT-4, we have to talk in terabytes. 1 terabyte is equivalent to more than 1 million novels. That is way more text than we have available for a tiny language like Icelandic. And besides how data hungry these models are, they are also famously expensive to train. And money, of course, is also a scarce resource in the world of low resource languages. It's really hard to justify spending hundreds of millions of dollars training a language model when your total market size is in the tens of thousands. So off the bat, when it comes to this new technology, things maybe aren't looking too rosy for the small languages out there. But thankfully, the news is not all bad. What we've discovered about these models, actually, is that they seem quite capable of something we refer to as cross-lingual transfer learning. What that means is that a model can essentially take what it knows about one language and apply it to a different language, often with remarkable results. So we probably don't have to train a model from scratch for every single language. We just need to figure out how to harness this learning power. Now, as with so many other things having to do with AI, we haven't quite figured out how to do that yet, but we are working on it. And I don't mean to throw big tech entirely under the bus either. My company has had a very successful collaboration with OpenAI, which is aimed at solving this problem of how to adapt English-centric language technology to a much smaller language. And as a result, GPT-4 actually performs much better in Icelandic than in probably most other languages with just a few hundred thousand speakers. But it still has quite a way to go before it can measure up to English. Now, some of you might be thinking, well, so what? You just told us that we've been living with English-centric language technology for practically as long as computers have been around. So what exactly is different now that we have arrived at the next generation of this technology? Well, according to some projections, the global economy stands to gain trillions of dollars annually due to productivity increases from generative AI. And you might want to ask yourselves, how is that money going to be distributed between the English-speaking world and the rest of us? If the choice for Icelandic companies becomes to either operate in English or to lose out on a bunch of savings, how confident are we that they won't simply follow the money? After all, most Icelanders are proficient in English, so what's the harm? Well, as I touched on earlier, the harm is that domain loss is one of the significant steps that lead to language extinction. Now, we've all been using language technology in one form or another for many, many years now, but we've been using it more as a supporting function. Think about it. Previously, you might type a business email and then send it through a proofing tool to get rid of spelling or grammar errors before sending it off. But in today's world, you're not writing that email yourself. You're providing a chatbot with some bullet points, and you're having that write the email for you. Now, that's a very significant change in how we are interacting with language technology, and that's a very significant threat to the languages that fall behind in building the technology that enables this level of automation. And it's not just about how well a chatbot speaks Icelandic either. It's about its awareness of our culture, our history, our values, because that starts to matter a lot too when you're using a chatbot to generate a lot of your text. And thinking beyond the business domain, I think we can all agree that we are becoming more dependent on English in our daily lives as our world fills up with more and more smart devices. And what about the children? Our kids are already consuming way too much content in English, be it TV shows, YouTube videos, computer games. As the potential for automating voiceovers in English increases, well, so does the gap between available content in English and other languages. And this extends to the educational domain as well, where school children are already being tutored by intelligent chatbots, in English, of course. If we don't get this under control, our kids' vocabulary and their engagement with their native language will surely suffer. So now that I've given you a whole laundry list of dangers that loom over our small languages, I think it's time to address the question that's at the heart of this talk. Do I think that linguistic diversity can actually survive this AI moment that we are having? Well, I think it can. In fact, I am confident that if we manage to solve this problem of how to efficiently incorporate small languages into large language models, then we won't just have given them a fighting chance, we will actually revolutionize the entire language tool ecosystem. And most importantly, we will finally level the playing field between English and other languages. That laborious process I described earlier of building a voice assistant, well, most of those steps will be a thing of the past as we move towards AI-based technology. Instead of developing complex grammars, we will be writing prompts. But of course, the opposite can also happen if we fail at this important task of creating an AI that works for all. In today's polarized debate around artificial intelligence, there seems to be no middle ground to be had. Either AI will doom us or it will save us. And so it goes with language technology. If we fail, then I am worried we are headed towards some sort of a disaster and even language death. If we succeed, well, then I think the future of linguistic diversity is bright. But either way, we just have to try to bridge this AI divide and give our small languages a fighting chance.